First, sessions are being done in collaboration both with the state of Texas through the State Energy Conservation Office, or CECO, which is under the State Comptroller's Office, as well as the North Central Texas Council of Governments, and it's all being funded by a grant from the United States Department of Energy to help educate people here today. That said, they also want to let you know that any of the opinions expressed in this presentation are mine, may not necessarily match or disagree with yours.
In the first section, we're going to have a history, the economics, concerns, and strategic planning for cities. This is the other half, so you're going to be seeing all of this. Cities often feel like they got to do everything by ordinance. We all understand the process that involves. It can take anywhere from 6 months to a year, and it doesn't have to be that way on solar electric equipment. Brief history, here we go. Very brief. I mean, we think of solar as new, and it's not. This is something that came back from the 1800s. That was a dish that focused the solar, or in this case, the sunlight, onto that cylinder in the center, boiled water, which ran a little steam engine, and that actually ran a printing press more than 150 years ago. Here was solar hot water on a home in 1906 in California. Solar electricity is a little bit newer development. Solar electricity, or at least knowledge of it, came before the 1900s, but it didn't really get commercialized until the phone company did it in 1955. That was about the era when it really was producible on a commercial basis. Here is your terminology. You have some of this in your handouts. If you want to write it down, please do. There is nothing technical here. But the word photovoltaic, that's like automobile. We don't say automobile, we say car. In our industry, we say PV. That just simply means electricity from light. Solar cell, that's a part of it, and that's a little piece that converts sunlight into electricity, or any light in this case. Photovoltaic module, it's a combination. It's all these solar cells connected together. This is a photovoltaic module. You can see the individual solar cells in it. That's the little square things. An array is just simply two or more of these hooked together. Direct current. This is electricity that flows like water in your garden hose. Always goes one direction. Your automobile runs on direct current. Alternating current is what you get from a wall outlet. The electricity just simply goes back and forth. There's reasons that they both work. There were reasons that they both actually serve a particular purpose. This is as technical as it gets. We talk about watts, like a 60-watt light bulb. And that is like the speedometer on your car. That tells you how much you're consuming at any given moment. Well, watts is how much electricity you're consuming at any given moment by an appliance or a device. Watt hours is the odometer. That's how far you've traveled, or the accumulated mileage, or in this case, for us, it's the accumulated consumption of energy. Typically, how much total is consumed in 1 hour. So we sit there and we look at it. Well, if you drive at 60 miles an hour for 1 hour, then that mileage will show up on the odometer. It's 60 miles more than what you had on it 1 hour ago. That's what the meter measures on your home. That's how you're billed on your utility bill. Kilo. This is a very easy one here. Just simply a thousand of something. Kilometers, kilometers means 1,000 meters. In this case, we're talking about electricity, so 1,000 watts is a kilowatt, or 1,000 watt hours is a kilowatt hour. That's how you are billed on your utility bill. This is the most technical as it gets right there. It's a little box. I'm leaning on one right here. It doesn't look like much. It's just an aluminum box here. And it's the device that changes the solar direct electricity, direct current, which we can't hook up to the wall or the utility lines, into alternating current like you would get from the power company. This box does the electrical magic, and it changes the direct current into suitable electricity to hook up to the utility. That's as technical as we get here. Now, this side of it you hopefully understand. There's some terminology here. To make best use of it, a home will have this equipment hooked up to the power grid, the utility grid, and it just simply means it's hooked up to the power lines. We talk about leased systems. Not everybody owns a system. There are companies that will lease systems. They'll put them on your house for free, and then you get to pay them for the duration of the ownership of their ownership on your roof. Net metering. Well, this is an interesting term. You get credit. If you consume 100 kilowatt hours and give back 50, then the utility company only bills you for that difference. You consume 100, you give back 30, you pay for 70. You follow me? You're only paying for what the difference was between what you consumed and gave back. So it's being billed for the net difference. Net zero. That just simply means that the amount of credit that you accumulated pretty well balances what you consumed. And you hear about net zero homes. We got builders around here that are building a net zero, meaning they got enough energy efficiency and solar and other things that what they consume and what they give back pretty well balance out, and they have basically a zero bill every month. Obviously not a really good plan for the utility company. That's what we'd all like. Not a good business model. Now we're going to spend a little time, you city officials, this is something that is here now for the city of Dallas. They just passed it. My commendations to your council and everybody else. This is a financing program that is very, very interesting, very flexible. It stands for Property Assessed Clean Energy. Parity is a term that we talk about. If I'm buying solar electricity for 10 cents a kilowatt hour, and I'm buying utility electricity for 10 cents a kilowatt hour, that's pretty well equal. I can pay the same amount of money for the solar as I do for the utility. They're equal. That means that's the term parity. Another example would be if I take out a loan and I buy solar electric equipment, put it on my home, maybe my loan payment was $90 a month, or will be. On the other side of that, maybe my utility bill drops by $90 a month. Well, guess what? I pay off that loan, and at the end that loan's paid off, it drops away. I'm getting that electricity now, and it's all paid for. This is parity. Power purchase agreement. Some people choose to lease, have a company put panels on their roof, and they agree to buy the electricity that it produces at some price. The nice thing is, generally, it's at a fairly known quantity of money. Utility power, that fluctuates. Our bills go up and down, kind of like the price of gasoline. Power purchase agreements are fairly consistent. This is an abbreviation for retail electric provider. Around here, you got Green Mountain Energy, you got TXU, you got other companies, Reliant, JEXA, Ambit, I mean, on and on and on. If you look on, there's a website here in Texas called Power to Choose. And that lists about 350 of these guys, retail electric providers. Incidentally, only 5 of them are shown as buying solar electricity back. Our state does not require it, nor do they require that they pay you anything for it. So consequently, we don't have very much in the way of that incentive, but luckily we still do. It's on a voluntary basis. Through this one in, zero energy home and net zero are pretty well acquainted with each other. It just simply means that home, all the energy production equals its consumption. That's as complicated as it gets. Any, have I lost any of you? That's the complicated part. Everything else is easy. Okay. This is a solar cell. You can see it in the solar panel right here. The whole thing is what we call a, come on, solar module. And in this particular example, that's just this one whole assembly right here. You put a bunch of them, two or more together, we call it a PV array. Could be 2, could be 200, doesn't matter. It's an array. Now, the way they're manufactured differentiates how they look. Some of them are very dark, like these are black. Others are kind of a mosaic blue. I've got an example of that in a little bit right here. This is a mosaic blue. It's the same material, it's silicon, it's window glass, same substance that you go out to the beach. They melt it, they process it, turns it into these things. That's the same material we make transistors out of. It's just how they process it. One method produces a little more efficiency at a higher cost, a little lower efficiency at a lower cost. That's the trade-off, meaning it's not a quality issue. You know, I guarantee you, for example, there are certain, we'll call it, you know, really high-end automobiles. They may get lousy mileage, but they're super high quality. So it's not an efficiency equals quality thing. Don't confuse the two, just how efficient they are in their manufacture. There's also another kind. These are also made out of either silicon, which is window glass again, formulated a little differently, or a couple of other sets of metals. This one's cadmium telluride. This is, cadmium's a toxic metal, but the company that makes these says, you ever need to send it back because it's worn out, broken, or whatever, we will recycle it responsibly. Then we have another one that we take the first letter of each of these words. Copper is a metal, indium is a metal, gallium is a metal, and selenium or selenide is a metal. C-I-G-S. We just call it SIGs. And no, it doesn't mean cigarettes. These are different methods. They're trying to get costs down and everything else. Now, where are these used? For example, this material is kind of grayish. I have an example right here. This is a solar shingle. It is made by a little company called Dow Corning. Solar panel part of it is down here where the glass is. This could actually, this goes on the house like a shingle. There's a whole bunch of them that all automatically hook together. You can see the color. It's kind of a grayish. It just happens to be that the metals and this thing go together and they look kind of this dark gray. Why can't they be made in other colors? One of the issues that I ran into with one of our local communities, they were saying, well, why, we want them to match these shingles. We want them orange, we want them brown, we want them green. Well, anytime you got orange, that means it's not absorbing the orange light, it's reflecting it. And if it's reflecting it, it didn't absorb it. And if it didn't absorb it, it didn't convert it into electricity. That's a big hit on the amount of energy that it produces over time. So they're dark because they want to absorb that light and not reflect it back. Here's how it works. In most cases, we have the solar panels on a roof of a home only because that's A, an area that's not otherwise being used. B, it's got usually pretty good exposure to sunlight. The little box that we call the inverter, I'm leaning on one, there are other kinds. That converts the direct current into household current. And then your utility meter. It'll measure how much energy you've consumed for the period of the month or how much you've given back. Five power companies will give you credit for energy that you send back to them through the power lines. Now, it saves you two ways. First, it'll provide you the energy that you're using in your home, and it'll also send everything else back and monitor the quantity that you've given. Now, this is a little technical. How are they? Well, we've got two different kinds of systems. One kind uses little boxes like this, one behind every solar panel. You don't see it, you don't mess with it, it automatically comes that way. It's automatically either attached by the manufacturer or the installer, either here or somewhere else, immediately behind the solar panel. But this little box takes solar electricity, and out this plug right here is clamps onto a cable. This comes out as AC, just like you get from the wall. This is called a micro inverter. And typically there's one per solar panel. The advantage is that for solar panels to work, if you got them all hooked up to each other, they all got to be facing the same direction. If you got some this way and some that way, then that's like taking the water hose and you kink the water hose. And if you kink the water hose, it doesn't matter where, beginning, middle, or end, all of the water slows down. Same thing happens here. So by having a micro inverter, got some solar panels facing this way, some facing this way, these guys are working individually at full power capability without being dragged down by the others. And our roof lines often do not allow us the luxury of having enough space to put all the solar panels in the same direction. Micro inverters, if you got a shading issue, grapevine, if you're over here somewhere near, you know, the mall, you got houses back in there that are terribly buried in trees, but they may have good solar exposure most of the time. Got a little bit of a shade issue. Shade is very detrimental to the energy output from solar panels. Even a little bit of shade is seriously detrimental. Consequently, when we sit down and we say, well, okay, I got to have absolutely clear shot at the sky, if you don't, a system may be put in using these microinverters and it might only affect just that one panel, but all the others are working at full tilt. This is how they look. It's those little silver boxes. They were attached. Now, if you'll notice, we've got some solar panels that are already in place here, more ready to go. It's a matter of just bolting it down, hooking up the wires, and clamping them to a cable. This is what we call a string system. So named only because the solar panels are connected in a string, almost like a long string of train cars. Plus to minus, just like flashlight cells, and you know, batteries in a flashlight kind of thing. Plus to minus, that's as complicated as it gets. They all come back to a common single inverter that may be located on the side of the house or in the garage or something. I'm leaning on a string inverter right here. This is a real working unit. I've actually opened it up during a break or after the session. You're welcome to come down and take a look inside. Doesn't do any good to look at Dad's watch from the outside. We all know what a watch looks like from the outside. Here, I've opened it up so you can see the inside as well. Same thing here. This microinverter, you may not understand what you're looking at, but it's kind of fun to look at it. Wow, that's what makes electricity right there. And they say, how does it work? Well, there's a little part in here, that's a computer. Somebody says, well, how does it know to turn on, turn off, and do everything that it does? Well, I got kind of a little bit of a rude answer. I just say magic. That's what it is. Okay. That's as technical as we're going to get before we get into the real heart of the matter. Do we have any quick initial questions? How durable are these on the roof and something like we get a hailstorm? Well, my common response is we don't get hail in Texas. We get bowling balls. Actually, these are designed to withstand a 1-inch hailstone at 55 miles an hour, and that is an underwriter's laboratory safety requirement. So any panels that are out there are certified to the UL standards. Doesn't have to be UL, could be any number of different laboratories that do the certification. They're guaranteed to handle at least a 1-inch hailstone at 55 miles an hour. Having said that, I got a very good friend of mine who used to be employed by the city of Plano. He's since retired. But he was up there in that hailstorm that dropped those grapefruit cannonballs on their houses up there. His roof was totaled, his pergola was totaled out in the backyard. He has 19 solar panels on his roof. I kind of figured he'd be buying 19 new ones, and believe it or not, the roof was totaled and none of the solar panels suffered any damage. Now, is that always going to be the case? My common answer is if it's going to break out the back window in your automobile, it'll break the solar panel. They are tempered glass, they will break. It becomes an insurance event. There was another part of that question. Yes, sir. Encore's got a fairly sizable awning and a couple other arrays that they do allow tours and so forth. And Encore is quietly pushing solar fairly hard. They're not allowed to sell or generate electricity commercially, but they're working with it because they see the advantages because it unburdens their power lines. You'll see why in a minute. Let's move on, the economics here. I don't know about you guys, but a lot of people tend to feel this way. Here's why everything is actually happening the way that it is. This is the area. Most of our electricity is generated by boiling water, running the steam through a turbine, spinning magnets and so forth, and then sending that electricity out onto the wires. Right in here is where it actually costs approximately for coal and natural gas. Well, it doesn't take rocket science to see where we were in 2012. And yeah, watch what happens. Between now and 2016, this is real numbers. In just the last 4 years, it has become cost competitive. In fact, the city of Austin just signed a power purchase agreement for solar electricity at a cost less than they were paying for commercial power. City of Georgetown just went 100% solar. And we're seeing it happen more and more. In other words, everything they're buying was produced either by renewable sources or derived in some manner from renewable sources. That's darn good. Here's why. Now, this is where this is our real pattern here. We have a NIMBY attitude, not in my backyard. I don't want to see the power plants. I want them 1,000 miles away from me, but I want to buy electricity for almost free. Well, that costs money. You got to transport it all the way. Well, here's our power plants. I joke about Texas being geographically challenged. We're not mountainous enough to have any real hydro plants, but Pacific Northwest you do, other places you do. Here, this is our power generation companies. In our area, it's nuclear, coal, and natural gas. That's it. Then we have the transmission and distribution, T&D. That's Encore. That's CenterPoint. That's other places around. You got them around the state. They own the power lines. They don't generate the electricity. They don't sell it. They just move it. They're the trucking line that takes that vegetable from the distribution point to you, the customer. Out here we have the retail electric providers. Those are the REPs that we saw in that abbreviation. Those are your TXUs, your Green Mountain Energies, your JEXAs, your Ambit Energies. I mean, there's 350 of them listed on that Power to Choose website. There's exactly 350, and I'm sure there may be more. And then we have the poorer customers like you and me on the end. So we're paying for all of this. The farther that has to go, the more loss they have, the higher the price. This is our power plant. We're going to start out, and we're going to either burn coal, natural gas. We're going to end up with half to two-thirds of that heat energy that it took to boil the water. Most of that's going up that stack. We're losing it. Between 44 and 68%, and by the way, I didn't invent these numbers. They came from a little organization known as the State of Texas. This comes from the comptroller's office. So, right out of the gate from the power plant, we got somewhere between a third and a half of the initial energy that we started to boil the water. Those big, ugly power lines that you don't like having in your own backyard, but you see them driving out on the open highway, that's another 8 to 10% lost. So that by the time it gets to our house, we've lost somewhere, if you will, between 50 and 70%. You could have as low as 30% of that remaining. So, why is that important? Okay, now I'm going to ask you a question here. All the city people in particular. This is a fun slide. Why do I have a tomato on the screen? I want you to, you have an answer for that? Oh, well, good. Well, maybe you read the article. I actually did a newspaper article on this whole thing about a week ago, and it showed up because I related that to the reporter. No? Well, you're close. But I want you to pretend that you live in Minneapolis. You got it. You guys are ahead of me. But we're going to draw a little story here real quick for the rest of you who haven't figured it out yet. You're in Minneapolis. It's during the holiday season. November, December, January. You decide you want to have a party for everybody. You're going to invite over some very close friends, associates, family, something like that. Part of that dinner is going to include a salad. And what do we put into salad? Carrots? Lettuce, cabbage, celery, tomatoes. You don't have any tomatoes. Well, it's December. I guarantee you, you're not growing December tomatoes in Minneapolis. Too cold. Even in a hothouse, you can't keep it warm enough. It's too cold. 40 below. Ask me how I know. I used to live there. Okay. So you drive down to the store and you buy a package of tomatoes and you take it home. Where did that tomato come from? That tomato came from where? Florida, California, Mexico? South Texas. Maybe South Texas. But it certainly didn't come from Minneapolis. And that means somebody started it out with that little tiny seed. They grew the plant, cultivated that plant, got it to a point where it produced tomatoes. Then they harvested those tomatoes, put them into a bunch of other tomatoes, shipped them off to the packing plant, put them into cartons, sent them off to distribution centers where they're then packaged into much smaller containers, driven to the various food stores so that you can drive in your car, go down and buy that package or even the loose tomatoes, take it home and put it in that salad. How much energy from beginning to end did it take to get that tomato to your table? A lot. I can't quantify it, but it's a lot. I mean, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to figure that out. Now, it's August. You've had a little garden growing in your backyard. It could be a container garden. That's what we do. Plant it and done. Water occasionally. That's it. August, you go out there. Wife decides she wants a tomato in the salad. Goes out, pops it loose, takes it in, washes it off. We're done. How much energy did it take to get that tomato to our table? This is the issue. We don't want the electricity in our backyard, so that means the power plants are way out somewhere and we got to send it over lots of wires and there's still a lot of loss in the system. When we do solar, that tends to be what we call local. That means it is grown like your tomato where it is used. Keep that in mind. Now, when we talk about the benefits to a municipality, you can go back to your planning and zoning, your council and other people. Cities that are solar friendly are seen as progressive, forward thinking. I'm going to share something with you that just came to our attention yesterday. You remember how we got the You remember we got a new facility up here, Toyota? Well, guess what Toyota just announced yesterday? I don't even have it in my slide deck. Toyota, as a result of building up there in that area, they added a very solar-friendly part of our metroplex. We have some solar-unfriendlies. Toyota is going to build, as a part of that facility up there, the largest commercial solar facility in the state of Texas. They just announced it yesterday. That has value. They saw that community, that area, that part of our metroplex is very solar friendly, very environmental friendly. They're doing their part. Solar homes themselves and the community sell anywhere from 4 to 50% faster, proven. I got the resources here. At a higher price, you have homes sitting on the market for less time, and they sell for higher prices than non-solar homes. That has value to your community. It may increase the overall property tax base because the community values increase. I worked, right now we had a community here about 2 years ago in our metroplex that decided they thought solar panels were ugly, and they passed an ordinance against any solar panels that could be seen pretty much anywhere on a home. If you can see it, you can't do it. You gotta get a special use permit, almost $600, and almost 6 months of processing to get it run through. They made the process so onerous that they dropped the number of installs in that city. They had one that year. That's how bad it was. They discovered the financial price of that because then they lost out on others. People said, ooh, we don't wanna go where they're restricted. I know of at least one builder that was gonna put together 35 home subdivision, $500,000 to $700,000 homes, 35 homes, not a lot, but when you look at the dollar value, approaching $750,000, they picked up that subdivision and moved it to another community. So there's value to the metropolitan area, value to your community. Here are some examples. This comes from Housing Wire magazine, and these are all very recent. This was April 2016. Now, yes, we are sitting here on an oil-rich community base, but guess what? People want solar. This is a very comprehensive report. Look at the start and end dates. 2002 to 2013, they studied almost 4,000 homes that were solar sales. That was more than 22,000, almost 23,000 sales altogether. And they analyzed that and said, what was the net benefit? One of the men doing the work is Tom Jackson down here at A&M. Very highly credentialed. He's got more credentials right now than his, anyway. Another lady by the name of Sandra Automatis, who's very well known in the real estate industry, and others. What did they find? They found that it added value. It reduced the time on market. I can attest to that, because in 2006, 2007, do you remember that was the worst part of the foreclosure market? I was out working in my backyard one Saturday. The neighbor's house had gone into foreclosure. There was a broker selling it. Right after I was sitting there making noise, and all of a sudden I hear this voice say, hey, can I talk to you? I said, sure. She said, is that solar you got on your house? I said, yes, it is. She said, would you like to sell it? That's not the kind of question you expect. It's like, hey, would you tell me more about it, was what I was expecting. And I said, why would I want to sell? She said, well, you realize the market is really, really nasty for homes. We've had inventory sitting on the market for 17, 18 months or longer. We can't sell it. She said, we had two homes in our inventory last year, and both sold within 48 hours because they had solar on them. She said, we want more houses like yours. Now, yeah, that's 10 years ago. Hasn't changed. Consequently, you fast forward to now, and it's even more popular because the costs have come down. So here was a study that was conducted very in-depth over many, many years across eight different states. Here's another one. This came from the United States Department of Energy, and this reinforced that study. You notice this one. They went back and they looked at it. This is a couple of years later and said, was this really accurate? And if anything, they found it to be conservative. They found it was even better than what the original report had discovered. Here's another one. This is from Phoenix, Arizona, the Phoenix Business Journal, a broker. He found that in a really down part of the year, November in Phoenix, the actual time on market was shorter for solar homes than non-solar homes. So the effect, how many studies, How many people here have seen an old movie called Miracle on 34th Street? Natalie Wood was a little girl. Some of you. Okay, I'm seeing about 50-50. Some guy ends up saying he's Kris Kringle. He's Santa Claus. The movie's about him being declared mentally incompetent and some attorney picking it up and saying, let me prove he's Santa Claus. Well, near the end of the movie, and I'm sorry, I'm going to spoil it for you who haven't seen it. They're sitting in the courtroom and Santa Claus is the defendant. Very nice man. And they bring in three letters from the United States Postal Service and put them on the judge's bench and say, well, here, these have just been delivered by a postal worker. And the prosecuting attorney gets up and says, well, I hardly feel like three envelopes constitutes evidence. He said, you want more? And the guy said, yeah. So the defense guy turns around and he goes like this. And in comes tens of thousands get piled up. It looks like a huge mound of snow on the judge's bench. He said, you wanted evidence? Here it is. I can bury you. I can sit down and I can look for this information on the internet. I have taught the internet and searching on the internet at the PhD level. So I like to think I'm at least pretty good at it. I looked for something that contrasted this information. I couldn't find it. So we have this report, we have this report, we have this report. All of these will be available online, by the way. You want to go out and look for yourselves? Here it is, or you can take my word for it. All of these have shown that the house appreciates in value and spends less time on the market. And at absolute worst, worst case, it has no negative effect at all. Worst case, again, it has no impact on the neighboring property values. It is not a detriment. In fact, there was a homeowner up here in Flower Mound a couple of years ago that went through a great big war with the city and with his HOA. And one of the things the city said is, oh, hey, this is going to have a negative effect on property values. And during the middle of this war, the neighboring house went up for sale on the market, and the guy that bought it came down to the city council at a public hearing and said, I bought it because my neighbor does have solar. I see this as a progressive city. That house sold in a matter of days because the neighboring house that everybody said was going to be so bad was the reason that guy bought the house in the first place. Impact of photovoltaic systems. Oh my golly, this is the state of Colorado. I don't call a Colorado Energy Office a biased resource. They have no vested interest in it one way or the other. They did an extensive study. And what did they find? They only looked at 30 homes that were sold that had solar, compared them to non-solar in same tract areas that were for sale, and they found that 87% had much shorter marketing times. The longer a house sits empty, the more detrimental it is to a community. They had higher prices, 70% because they had PV. Here is the evidence. You want more than three envelopes on the judge's bench? I can bury you in envelopes. I don't want to. Arizona Public Service, this is the power company, largest in Arizona, conducted a study. They conducted it through a research agency, an organization that studies 94% of their customers support solar. Here's another one, and yet more. I think you begin to get the picture. As people representing municipalities, this is something your citizens want. This was actually conducted by the Center for Real Estate at UCLA. And what we find is regardless of the community, regardless of who conducts the study, the numbers come out pretty well the same. It's not up here for one and down here for another. They're finding it the same regardless of when the study was conducted, regardless of who conducted it, or where it was conducted. They're all coming up with pretty much the same information. That's almost like saying, okay, I'm going to put water on the stove and I'm going to put a thermometer in that water and I am going to boil that water. Guess what? It all pretty much boils around 212 degrees Fahrenheit. Okay, I'm talking about at the same altitude. Yes, there are differences in communities. But disregarding that, let's say you can go from, let's say, far east. We can go out here to Tyler, or we can go out to Weatherford, and we can look at everything in between, and you can conduct a study, and you're going to find pretty much that water boils at 212 degrees. What we have here in our marketing area is that solar is something that adds value and reduces time on market. It doesn't matter where it is. So, that's a quick summary. Every study, didn't matter who conducted it, found positives. There were no negatives whatsoever. I looked and I looked and I looked. The only thing that I found was leasing, and it made it a little bit more difficult we talk about that. But I'm talking about where it's owned and sitting on the house already. And in 2006, November, when I have a broker reach over the fence to me and say, hi, I want to buy your house so that we can sell it again. Or, hi, I want you to sell your house so that we can represent you. And that was at the bottom of that slump. And they're actively seeking solar inventory. That spoke volumes to me. Cost of solar electricity is stable. Fuel prices vary. Cost of coal, cost of natural gas goes up and down. A few years ago, we were paying 16 cents per kilowatt hour. All of a sudden, the fracking came into being, and boom, prices tanked. Yeah, for now, but all of a sudden now, the oil prices have gone down, the amount of fracking has gone down, electricity costs are creeping up, so are gasoline costs. I remember when it was $1.88, now I'm paying $2.14. You know, it's kind of like we call it the boiled frog syndrome. I've never tried this, but I've always heard that if you take a frog and put him into cold water and gradually elevate the temperature, because he's cold-blooded, he takes on the temperature of his surroundings, and you'll be able to boil that water and kill the frog, and he'll never know it. It happens so slowly and gradually, you don't even notice it, but it's all of a sudden like, hey, when did that happen? Well, it wasn't overnight. Now, I have a little bit of a presentation here. This comes from the Council of Governments. This is kind of a quick overview of what's going on here in the Metroplex right now.
Solar energy is the conversion of sunlight into electricity. An ideal location for solar use, Texas has the highest unused solar potential of any other state, and Texans are beginning to realize that potential.
We spread 30 panels across three installation sites on the roof. Prior to putting them on, I did have a conversation with all of my neighbors about what I was planning to do, and the reaction was incredibly positive. In fact, most of them wanted to know more about it.
This is our West Irving Library. This library was completed in April of 2011, and since that time we've generated over 1.2 million kilowatt hours of electricity.
City of Plano has taken a very active approach in solar initiatives. Some of the benefits that the City of Plano have received through the installed projects, one is from the standpoint of a community acceptance. They gave the community an understanding of exactly what it does, what it looks like, and what it doesn't look like.
Solar power generates more than just clean, quiet electricity. It creates local jobs, stabilizes electric costs, eases the burden on the power grid, and helps keep our air clean by reducing dependence on power plants that use fossil fuels. Some residents and municipalities may also enjoy financial payback from their electric provider for producing excess solar energy. Take action to become involved in the region-wide solar initiative known as Solar Ready 2, and join the effort to create consistent, standardized solar policies that will help remove obstacles to solar implementation and help power a cleaner, brighter future for North Central Texas.
The key here was that first guy that said, I talked to my neighbors, I let them know that I was going to be doing this. He was apprehensive. Not only were the neighbors receptive, they said, tell us more about it. We want to be doing it too. This is the key here. At a time when jobs are a little hard to come by, guess what? Solar industry is hurting. Take a look. Now, California has the most solar jobs of any state in the nation. Well, they're the biggest solar and everything else. We're here. Guess who's got more than us? By a factor of two. Little Massachusetts. They had 15,000. Nevada, New York, New Jersey? New Jersey is ahead of Texas. What's wrong with this picture? Look at how much area we have. We have the largest solar resource in the nation. And we're clear down there in the jobs list. So Texas is not a terribly solar-friendly state. Now, we now have twice as many solar workers in the U.S. as we have coal miners. We generated jobs 12 times faster. We now employ more than the oil and gas industry. And that number, if you take a look, comes from the United States Department of Labor. This is a snippet that came in off of Channel 5 locally. In 2014, we had 905 working rigs, operating oil rigs, but because of the tanking of the oil prices, right now we have 197. That's a lot of oil workers displaced. Little town of Haskell, about an hour north of Abilene, they turned around and hired 450 of the 700 unemployed oil workers and put them to work in solar. And it doesn't stop there, it branches. You end up with the customer on the solar side, but look at all the other jobs that it involves. One job brings in many. I have a prime example of that near San Antonio. So not only do you have the customer, you got all of that. Not only does that, it brings in manufacturing. I got a slide coming up, but look at when you have a product manufacturer, look at everything around them that also comes along with it. You want employment in your community? Take a look at what's going on here. This is called Mission Solar near San Antonio. You ever hear of them? Take a look at the numbers. Why? CPS Energy, the largest municipal energy owned energy company in the United States, decided to put in a huge facility, and it brought along this company, $250,000 in a permanent, quarter million square feet, in a permanent facility, 400 plus employees, but there was more. Seven other companies co-located with Mission, not only to support them, but to support the product and the project and other things at the same time. Net economic benefit more than 700, actually I said more than seven, it's more than 785 million was the real number. I kept it conservative. That's just to the economic benefit of San Antonio. Take a look at another one here. This is why. I love this one. Little humor here. More employees. You got to keep the grass down. I love it. CPS Landscapers. Grass goes in, fertilizer comes out. Win-win. And they can be under the solar panels. They love it. By the way, a little ancillary support. They had a contest. They named him Watson. Houston, Solar Tech is a company, you're gonna love this one, based in Mexico. They located in Houston. They're getting ramped up right now, $285 million positive economic impact in the Houston area in the next 3 years and going up from there. So who does this involve? That involves everybody. You folks here are state, city, municipal representatives. It involves you. It involves the fire and code inspectors. We had a very full-blown session with them this morning. It involves the code officials. You go out and you inspect the systems after they're installed. Building and design professionals. These are the folks that actually do the design work, the engineers and so forth. Now, I want to hover on this one for just a moment. Veterans and military. We got a lot of folks that have come back and are actually coming off of duty from the military looking for work. We got at least a partial solution for that. The utility companies are getting involved. Encore particularly is very heavily involved. Real estate, we had a full-blown session on that. They want to sell these houses. They sell faster and at a premium. Now, this is a program for veterans. 3 weeks ago, the United States Department of Energy launched a training program for vets who want to get involved in solar. It's called, simply enough, Solar Ready Vets. One of them is right here in Texas. The Joint Base near San Antonio, Air Force and Army. Here are the others around the nation. It's installation primarily, but there's a lot of other jobs that go along with it. It's the design work. It's the transportation. It's the inspection. It's everything. It's all aspects of the solar. Primarily, the installers are needed. We're changing people from blacksmiths to auto mechanics. These are all over, and the goal is to train 75,000 of them by 2020. That's only 4 years away, not even. Okay, expedited permitting. This is the focus. One of the things that we're trying to do is get what we call the soft costs down. In our state, in our nation, our costs to install are about three times what they are in other parts of the world. If it costs us, let's say $1.50 here, it costs 50 cents over in Europe. Because we got so much paperwork and so many of these things that are not necessarily required. It's just our hoops that we got to jump through. We put them there. We don't need them. North Central Texas Council of Governments has spent 2 years, the ladies in the back row here and their colleagues have really put in some effort. They came out with an excellent template for communities to use. Now, this is expedited permitting. It's easier for your community. The city of Plano was a leader in this. Do we have anybody here from Plano? What a bummer. Used to. kind of, sort of. I understand. You got it. Bill and I banter. He and I have known each other for years. This is the only other guy I know that is actually super qualified to be doing some of this code work and everything else. Everybody else is kind of wanting to be. He's there. He used to be with Plano. He understands what I'm about to tell you. The city of Plano put together a program that turned out to be so popular it ended up being a pattern for other communities. Interesting thing about it is they ended up with organizations, grassroots organizations, forming to help bring more solar in. Plano turned out to be remarkably popular for that reason. So, when you talk about expedited permitting, they want to provide resources, improve air quality, increase local energy, and the grid reliability. If you're lowering the burden on the grid, it improves its reliability and reduce costs. Now, here is what the results netted from that two-year very strong effort. We had 33, that's about 15% of our local communities took direct active part. 345 participants. We took care of their specific questions, answers, concerns, and barriers. 3 permit process guidelines. They are there for your community to use. Take it, it's free. It's already done for you. And it led to the contract with the state of Texas to help further the cause of solar. Here's what it looks like. And there's not much to it. Basics, site information, and the size of the system and everything else. That's page one. Page two, not any worse. Contractor, electrical, code compliance, zoning district, are you in? If you can answer all of these with a yes, it's qualified for expedited permitting. One of the suggestions, and I want to bring this to your attention, is this weight limit. There's been a concern. The city of Allen, city of Dallas, I even talked to Dallas code officials. They said, we require a structural analysis on every home because we want to make sure that it's not going to cave in the roof. Well, extensive studies have shown that homes built since the roughly 1974 International Residential Code was released, which required 2x6s, 24 inches apart, holding up your roof, those turned out to be remarkably conservative as far as their estimates of strength. Studies recently conducted by the University of New Mexico, by Sandia National Laboratories, found 300% margin in roof strength compared to what they thought it would have. Structural is not necessary. We do have communities that put it there because they say out of an abundance of caution. City of Dallas is one. There are others, but very few, thankfully. Maybe a couple dozen out of our over 200. It is not necessary on homes built since the mid-1970s. Pre-1970, mid kind of term, then I will go along with it and say, yeah, you got to have a structural professional engineer come in and say, you know, how strong is that roof? All the rest of this, what angle are they going to be sitting? Electrical connection and fire safety. You meet all of those, it qualifies for the expedited permitting. It's easier for the client. More importantly, it's easier for the city. Translation, lower cost. You standardize the permitting requirements. I realize every community wants to put its own fingerprints on the ordinances and requirements. They all want to make it unique to them. You take a look at the high school, no two students want to dress alike. I want to be my own unique person these days. Cities seem to be wanting the same. Well, I'm not going to copy that city. I want to do it my own way. And yet they'll look to see how that other city did it, and they'll take snippets from here, snippets from there, snippets, and then they'll put it all in one, and they'll call it theirs. Unfortunately, sometimes they tend to take the bad parts of the snippets. You need advice. Now, I will highlight something as public record. The city of Allen, about almost 10 years ago, went through the ordinance birthing process. They didn't reach out for anybody. They were asking on the record, it's on their website, says, hey, what are solar panels made of? They talked to their senior planner for the city. He says, I don't know. I think they're made of plastic. They require that they be shielded. They have glare concerns, all other things. None of them are necessary. They're in the process now of revising it because they discovered, finally, somebody approached them and said, let me help you understand this. And they went, wow, okay, we did it out of an abundance of caution. It wasn't necessary. Let's fix it. Problem is, it takes 6 months to a year to fix it. That costs you time at public hearings, all kinds of stuff. Eventually it happens, but why do it in the first place? Why spend the money if you don't need to? Item number 2, post your concise permits on their website so that people know going in what you require. Don't waste the time. Most of the communities don't have that posted. I am a professional design engineer. I am a registered professional engineer with the state of Texas. I am no dummy. I can't get this information. I literally have to call and say, what do you require? And then I get somebody on one phone line that says, okay, well, we require A, B, and C, and somebody else tells me X, Y, Z the next day, and they're different. Same community. Make certain that they're consistent. Number three, educate your permit inspectors. These are the people that look at the documentation. A couple of systems I was asked to assist on here recently. Matter of fact, in one of our larger communities, the inspection was rejected, their permit was rejected. They said, well, we require that it has something called rapid shutdown. Well, it involved use of these guys. These are strictly AC. There's no high voltage DC involved anywhere in this kind of system, these little microinverter things. They are exempt from something that shuts down the high voltage because there isn't any high voltage, but the city was requiring it anyway. And it took an hour of sitting down and step-by-step explaining it to that particular permitting official and saying, this is why it's not required, but they had been requiring it of everybody prior to that. So educate your permit and other staff about solar. Number four, solar HOA law. How many people are not aware of what we call the HOA law in Texas? Not aware of it. Wow. You all know about it? I'm impressed. Here it is. House Bill 362, enacted in 2011, and it prohibits an HOA from restricting homeowners. A lot of people are not aware of it. I've done presentations on this, and nobody's heard of it, including the HOAs. Passed by an overwhelming bipartisan vote. 31-0 in the Senate, 143-1 in the House. I consider that overwhelming. Thing is, the procedures by the homeowner must be followed, and the HOA does have a limited voice in saying where they can be installed. The one catch is it's determined by the total energy that it will be producing over the course of a year. If the homeowner wants to face them south toward the sun, and the HOA says, no, we want them facing east so they can't be seen, I can tell you right up front, the south facing will be about 30% more energy produced through the course of the year than the east or west. In that case, the HOA would not prevail, the homeowner would. If there's, let's say, a southeast or a southwest angle where they're both kind of sort of about the same, the difference between the two might be less than 10%, then the HOA is going to win, but those are rare. Usually it's a south or east-west kind of an issue. HOAs don't want them where they can be seen. I educated an HOA president on solar here a few years ago, and not only did they turn around and they actually turned around and removed the restrictions on him, he was the first customer for solar in that HOA. Now, if you gotta have a permit ordinance, if you have to have an ordinance, here are three bullet points that are sort of suggested items for that ordinance itself. Allow the solar energy devices, tell them that you gotta meet applicable safety requirements, and that you gotta have an interconnect agreement with the utility company. Those are your fundamental items. The city of Flower Mound did this here a few years ago. But keep in mind that ordinances where you start dealing with aesthetics are gonna be very difficult to, you may have problems because you cannot equally enforce ordinances where you have aesthetic requirements. Community that I know of said, well, if the front of your house faces south, you can't have solar panels, but if the back of your house faces south, you can. That's unequal enforcement of that ordinance, and that will be easily challenged. It may take some time, but I promise the city is going to lose. Regulations need to focus on safety. I see a lot of the extraneous rules talking about non-functional systems have to be repaired or removed. Sure, you can put that in, but it's a waste of your time because number one, you're never going to know that the system's not functional, and number two, the owner of that system is going to be losing money if he doesn't get it fixed. Kind of like a rental property you didn't have rented. Remove the overly cautious restrictions, and we talk about things like glare. Is glare an issue? Talk about that in a moment. Community solar. Not every home is suitable for solar. Community solar gives people an option. and then make brownfield or otherwise unusable land available for community solar systems. Here's this is point by point. What is community solar? Very simply, you're going to have homes like over here in the Mustang District around Grapevine Mills Mall. Beautiful oak trees, 30, 40, 50 years old. Some of those homes have got shade year-round. Suitable for solar? No. And I do not advocate cutting down trees. They have a greater value to that property than the solar will. But what happens if I want to have at least some vested interest in a solar, if I have a solar community solar facility, and let's say it's got, pick a number, 1,000 solar panels in it, and I buy 10 of those, then I will get a percentage of that energy production from that little solar facility credited toward my utility bill, not on my house. I still get a reduction. The only thing that I don't get is the added benefit of having an increased valuation of my property. Neat thing is, though, let's say I move from that house to another house, that credit could follow me. So it's got some pros to it. It also puts otherwise unused land in your community to some use. We're talking about areas that may not be suitable for building. We're talking about land that may have been landfills or other things. Put it to some use, that's an option. Okay, now, this is probably key here. This is for your businesses. You want to attract businesses to your community. I realize that every city here is in competition with every other city. You want dollars. You want residents, you want jobs, you want everything in there that you can utilize for income. Cities are a money machine, or try to be. Nice thing about being in the position I'm in, I get to see the emperor has no clothes on once in a while. This is one of those times. I understand you got to have money to operate on, but it also is helpful if you have an increasing revenue base as your city grows. This is PACE, Property Assessed Clean Energy. Now, it's not a government handout or government funding. It's only for business at the present time, but it does apply to nonprofits. And it allows low interest, low risk financing up to 100% of the cost of a system and other energy improvements. It's not limited just to solar. Now, I've got a gentleman here from the Texas PACE Authority who was kind enough to drive up here from Austin. I'm going to turn the screen over to him for just a few minutes and let him run through. He's got just about 7 slides. And I'd like him to explain particularly to our municipal representatives what PACE is. To their credit, the city of Dallas just passed it. And now businesses in their community can take advantage of this very nice financing options. Thank you guys from the city of Dallas.
Hello everyone. Yeah, my name is Peter Herlin. I'm the program manager for the Texas PACE Authority. And we are a 501c3 nonprofit that administers the PACE financing mechanism here in Texas. And yeah, I'll talk more about PACE. So PACE, as we said, is Property Assessed Clean Energy, and it's a financing mechanism. Now, our proposition for what the benefits are is that it's 100% financing, and the project pays for itself. Now, the PACE ultimately will increase the building's net operating income and decrease utility costs. That ultimately leads to more value from the building. And once again, there's no capital out of pocket used for upgrading your building or retrofitting your property. Now, once again, PACE is not a government program. It's not a government incentive. There's no government money involved. And part of what I'm going to pitch to local governments today, to municipalities, is that it is at no cost to add a PACE program to where you are. There's no government money, and all it will be is an economic development tool for your local government, your county is what we prefer, or your municipality. So how does it work? Well, it's structured very similar to a loan in that a borrower would take out a sum of money and pay it back over a number of years. The difference is that it is a long term for the financing, 20 to 30 years, and since the term is so long, your repayment is going to be less than what you're saving for the improvements. And once again, a key difference with PACE is that unlike being secured to the borrower, the PACE is secured by a senior lien placed on the property itself. And that is a key distinguishing factor for PACE. A lot of conventional financing might be 10 years for Wells Fargo for solar or something like that, but that is different because it's not tied to the property itself, the senior lien. So the mechanism is very similar to a property tax. So it's like you're voluntarily raising your property taxes to pay off a long-term loan. So what are some of the PACE benefits? Well, there are a couple of problems for energy efficiency right now in solar, and PACE solves three of them that I want to highlight. First of all, the long, simple payback. A lot of energy efficiency retrofits, solar panels, they can be maybe expensive up front, and the return of investment is more than 2 or 3 years. Well, that might be out of the budget for a lot of property owners. Well, PACE flips this entire metric on its head. Since it's such a long term, and the payment is less than what you're saving, you immediately realize a positive cash flow the first year and every year that you're using PACE. So this enables the no extra capital out of pocket for putting together a PACE. The second one is split incentives. A lot of buildings, multifamily, maybe you've got tenants in there, and they're paying the utilities, and so the property owner, why would they increase the efficiency of the building? Well, through a triple net lease mechanism, the PACE assessment can be passed through and the incentives can be lined up. Triple net lease, for anyone who doesn't know, it is where the tenant shares with the maintenance, the insurance, and the property taxes. And so that's where PACE can be slided in through that assessment. The next one will be the short holding period. Suppose you're a building owner and they're not sure how long they're going to hold on to that property. There's a fear of overinvestment. Maybe you don't want to add solar panels because you're going to sell the building in 3 years. Well, PACE stays with the land. So the new owner of the building will pick up the PACE assessment right where the seller left off. And what's really interesting here is that if you take out a Wells Fargo loan or something for solar finance, the new buyer, the Wells Fargo may be interested in the credit, and well, you might have to pay off that initial loan before you sell the land. Well, with PACE, it's not about the buyer's credit. I mean, as long as the new property owner has been paying their property taxes, that's all that's necessary for PACE. So it's a fully assumable by the next owner. Let's go back, actually. So what I want to pitch to municipalities here is that PACE is an economic development tool that enables growth and improvements without any net migration to your city or town. So PACE is a great way to create jobs, and it doesn't require any public funds or any government money. So what is eligible? So it's hard to talk about what is eligible for PACE, and it's got to be in an active PACE region. Since it operates through the local government or a taxing authority, it's got to be within a PACE region. So like I mentioned, as of May, the city of Dallas is within a PACE region. So if you have property here, that is eligible for PACE. So the second thing is it's got to be an improvement that will save energy or water or have some distributed generation capacity. So that could be HVAC, that could be lighting, that could be solar, that could be CHP. Any of those, it's got to be permanently affixed to the property. And the type of property is really important. So it's got to be private property that's non-residential property right now. So it is not eligible for single family right now in Texas. But that includes nonprofits and churches and museums. Yes.
Can you also clarify how multifamily residential fits in?
Right. I'll just skip down there. So multifamily, it's got to be 5 or more units. But so nonprofits, the first 2 PACE projects in Texas were both nonprofits. Because if you're a nonprofit, it turns out most of your funding is probably going to your program. Well, then there's a lot of delayed maintenance on your HVAC, you won't be able to put in solar, you might not have a huge budget, but using PACE, you can add all of these improvements without spending extra money out of pocket. Commercial buildings, we're talking office, retail, those are all eligible. Industrial, including agricultural, which is one reason why we like to prefer to work with counties rather than just municipalities. We'll get to that later. I mean, multifamily, like I said, with 5 or more units. No government buildings are allowed, that's not for PACE, and then no greenfield development.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
Multi-unit meaning is it 5 units in one building or 5 buildings?
Five units in one building. Yeah. So here's an example of our first PACE solar project. It's not the first project, but the second project. But it's the first one to have to use solar on their building. So Family Elder Care is a nonprofit in Central Texas. They work with the elderly at disadvantage. And they were interested in putting solar on their building, but they had an old roof that was worn out, was leaky, and they needed a new one. So they went to their solar contractor and said, well, we wanted solar panels, but we need this roof, we need a new roof. So they had to get a cool new roof as well. Well, it turns out they could finance the whole thing with PACE, and it was about a $260,000 total project cost. But they ended up saving about 148,000 kilowatt hours saved a year. And the project was about 20 years for the assessment. I've got the case studies out there somewhere. And the assessment was probably a little bit more than 23,000 a year, but they're saving more than that, so that they're paying off that assessment and their cash flow positive. So it didn't have to impact their budget at all. All right, so here's the most important part. How do we start PACE? So if you're not in the city of Dallas, or you're in Tarrant County, or you're in Colon County, or you're in another county besides the city of Dallas, or the Travis County, Williamson County, if you're outside of those areas, let's talk about how you get started. Well, the most important thing, contact the Texas PACE Authority. We will be able to help you set up a plan for getting PACE in your county or your municipality. We'll be able to connect key players with other government officials who've already experienced PACE, who've already worked with PACE, you know it. There's a huge component of community outreach that's all about setting up PACE, so it starts with that. PACE in a box. So what's important to know about PACE in a box is PACE in a box is a set of guidelines for establishing PACE in your region or your area. PACE in a box, it was a group of 130 stakeholders, including the Texas Municipal League, the Texas Council of Urban Counties, and the Sierra Club, the CECO, a Dow Chemical, a huge group of stakeholders came together to create PACE in a box, which is just a guideline for best practices for PACE. PACE outside of Texas looks very different. It's not necessarily an open market model, meaning with open market, you have multiple lenders, and you can sort of pick and choose. And the best PACE in a box has these best practices, which enables for the uniformity and for the most easy PACE approaches. So, the next aspect is the local government outreach and education. So again, we will come and we will do presentations, we'll do programming for education and outreach. The key part is we need to educate key staff members in your local government about PACE. They need to vet the program, they need to understand the program. And then once that's achieved, there'll be a formal process of publishing a report, establishing a resolution of intent to do PACE, and then there'll be a public hearing, and then there'll be a formal resolution to adopt PACE in your county or local government. And then you'll sign a contract with the administrator, and then you'll be able to run PACE. So we are the Texas PACE Authority. We are a 501c3 nonprofit. We are a PACE in a box open market administrator. Here are some contact information. Charlene Hattinger is our president, and she does a lot of business development. She'll be able to help push PACE for different counties. Jonathan Blackburn is our managing director. He can do a lot of the operations and a lot of the technical questions. I'm Peter Rowan, the program manager, and we are happy to help however we can get PACE to reach. And I'm happy to answer any questions.
Peter, when we first started talking about PACE a year or so ago, yes, one of the issues that came up was the administrative burden that having a PACE district places on the local government.
Right. Yeah, so what happened was, a little short history of PACE. PACE was adopted in 2013 as a statute for Texas, creating PACE, which enabled local governments to create PACE programs. Well, what she's talking about is that there's a huge burden to do the administration of these PACE programs, and so therefore, the TPA nonprofit was created specifically to administer PACE at no cost to the local government. So that is our pitch, is that we will administer the PACE program at no cost to the local government. Good question.
So your staff will grow as the municipalities, counties join?
Correct.
So if you get a PACE program established in a county, county, then you have individual cities within that county that could also adopt the base? I mean, is that the way it
goes? Well, once you have the county, you know, you're going to get all that unincorporated area, so that will be hopefully the baseline for PACE. So for instance, for the city of Dallas, suppose Dallas County joins the PACE program, then we'll probably work mostly with the county for placing those assessments, because that incorporates the larger area.
So how would a small city within a county PACE program
apply for programs? Yeah, so if you're in a small town and you're trying to get PACE, yeah, we want you to pressure your county commissioners to adopt PACE. And again, we'll work with you independently to get that.
So I think just to clarify this question is, if a small city or any city within a larger county area, so like in Tarrant County, we have 39 cities within just Tarrant County. If Tarrant County were to adopt PACE as a countywide program, would all of those cities automatically, any business, commercial business, be eligible in any of those cities, or would each individual city of the 39 cities have to do an individual resolution to their councils?
Okay, yeah, so to clarify, if the county adopts PACE, then every city within that county can use PACE.
Automatically. They don't have to do any extra steps.
No.
Clearly it's beneficial if you guys have influence, better to do it at the county level, right? Individual city.
Yeah. So, for example, there was a property owner that I got a call not too long ago, just south of this line right here. And they said, hey, we want to put solar panels on our school. And I said, okay, well, where's the property? Well, they're in the county of Dallas, but they're outside of the city limits. And so because of that, we couldn't use PACE on their property. So we want to do counties where available.
Is there a limited pool of funds?
So as of right now, we have over 10 private capital investors lined up with over $2 billion ready for PACE projects. So there's no upward limit.
Just in the state of Texas?
Just in the state of Texas. So there's a huge sum of funds available.
I would also just comment on that whenever there are presentations on PACE to property owners or yesterday to the realtors, there's a lot of interest, so I think there is appetite for companies to be able to do PACE projects. Our limiting factor right now is a lack of PACE districts. So to Dan Peter's point, to the extent that y'all are even, and we hear it in the council governments all the time, we'd love to do PACE, and we are glad to be supporting.
Well, let's get the county involved. The county dragged their feet. I can see where a municipality would say, well, we're not going to wait for you guys, let's go ahead and do it. It took Dallas a little while to get it up and running. You can kind of see what Dallas did. PACE in a box gives you everything you need to start with. And you get the county on board, get your county commissioners, get your county judge, sit down and say, this is how it works, this is what we want. Sometimes it takes outside pressure.
Yeah. And especially if you have a project, that will definitely light a fire if you've got a project ready to go.
Building agencies, say, you don't have players in your county, you have smaller regional banks or something like that, will they be able to participate?
Yeah, one of the keystones of the PACE in a Box is that, yeah, your local banks can lend for this PACE product. So PACE is a good economic development tool because a local bank can be the one to do the PACE loan in a local town.
There's just something about Dallas that confuses me. There's a county city. Why not want to say, okay, let's do this for the county. And since we're going to go with the program, we'll benefit from it, so we'll all convert. I mean, I don't see any reasons we're not.
Two different governments, but I was talking today with someone from the city of Dallas, and they're talking about getting the county to just sort of join their program.
Well, Dallas has done it. They're sort of our proverbial 800-pound gorilla.
Yeah.
Where goes Dallas, they kind of, everybody else gets sucked along in their wake. Once people see how it works, they're going to go, it's not easier than we thought. Let's go ahead and do it. They've broken the ice. I expect them to follow through.
I'm working with the PACE program. I think the one initial roadblock that everyone identifies is that the PACE lead is partner.
Right.
And so they don't quite understand.
Yeah.
500 feet that way.
Yeah. So the question or the concern was the status of the senior lien on the property. Why would a mortgage holder consent to a senior lien? And I mean, I can get that independently, but like the short two answer, quick and dirty answer is that the debt service coverage ratio has improved. So the ability of the property owner to pay back the mortgage has improved. The second reason is the improved collateral of the building. Since net operating income has increased, the ability, the collateral that the mortgage holder has is improved.
What can state government do? Guess what? Here it is. We're talking about what's called net metering. In these states right now, they have no requirements at all. Now, notice it's only three. In these states, they do have some form of state-mandated compensation. In these states, they have mandatory, meaning the public utilities have said and the state legislators have said, you got to pay these folks for that energy that you give them back. Right here, look what. There's only two states. There are no mandates. It's all voluntary. We can change that. We've attempted to, but we haven't been successful. Why? Very simply, in 2007, we had a law that said net metering shall be deployed, but it got gutted. It's almost as if, and I'll tell you what, this kind of irks me just a little bit. One of the things that didn't get mentioned, I used to be on a radio show, a little network called National Public Radio. Started out local and we went national. We ended up on NPR for 5 years. We were also on the USA Radio Network. I leveraged that position, and I bring that here to your attention now. If you notice here, we tried to pass it, but it failed in 09, 11, and 13 because the electric companies have got a huge lobby down there in Austin, and solar has virtually nothing. Problem was that when we get into that situation, one of the things, we got within a whisker of having it 1 year, and it's on public record. This is not a slam against any of our representatives or anything else. But Sylvester Turner, representative from Houston, did a point of order 1 year, 5 minutes before midnight, on a particular aspect involving solar energy, where it would have created at least a huge pool of money to help. And that point of order killed it. So I called him the following week and I said, why did you do that? On hearing I was radio, national, he said, boy, I'd love to talk to you. He said, well, because it would have increased the utility bills on my constituents, even if they don't want solar, and I won't stand for that. I said, Mr. Turner, sir, do you know how much? He said, it doesn't matter. I said, sir, it was 10 cents fixed. No riser, no increase, nothing for inflation, 10 cents. And I had that long pause, and he said, I got to go. Click. Somebody told him, but he didn't bother to say how much. They just said, man, this is going to raise their utility bills. And he said, man, I won't have that. They didn't give him the full picture. And we haven't been able to get it started since. Now, this is what happened here. This was the story about it. And there it is. Anyway, so what else can we do? Besides the state-mandated net metering, we've got some other things that we can take a look at. We call parity. I defined that earlier. We now have parity. You borrow money under the right conditions, and in states that are in green right now, it costs, as you know, the loan payment and the offset in the utility are equal, or in our case, even better. We can actually come out with a loan that is paying less money than what we're saving. We're already ahead in those states. It's already forecast that these states will be by 2018. Just 2 years from now, because of the constant increasing in prices of the energy. We talked about parity. I'll define it again briefly. Take out a low-interest loan. It just simply says, hey, my payment's smaller than what I'm saving. I'm coming out ahead. Another interesting comparison here. Country in red is Germany. That's its relative size compared to the United States. We have 3,900% more sunlight than Germany. Take a look where Germany is in relative latitude compared to the United States. They're up there in Canada compared to us. And yet, look at something. They have 3.6 as much area, but 6,000 more percent solar than the US. They're not hung up on, gee, it looks ugly or whatever. They don't have the barriers that we do. And there was a time a year and a half ago, yes, admittedly during a holiday, when they found that more than half of that country's electricity came from renewable energy at one point. That's darn good, 51%. So, other things communities can do, you can ask for or require solar-ready features in new construction. If you're familiar with the International Residential Building Code, the state of Texas is going to adopt it in September. I suggest you look up Appendix U. It requires solar be incorporated into all new homes. Solar ready, space available, no obstructions on the south-facing areas or the solar sunny areas of the roof. They have changed the building code. That becomes state law here later this year. All new houses built that are under that law are going to have solar-ready areas or solar-available areas on them. Strengthen your solar access laws. These are already in place in many states. In the state of Texas, we do have a little bit, but not very much. You can follow the leads. California, Arizona has one. It's been challenged up to the Court of Appeals. Not a problem. Same thing in Florida. If somebody's already invented the wheel, why reinvent it? Reach out and see what others have done that work. Prohibit misleading fees and tariffs. Let me show you a little picture here. We got two homeowners, side by side, tract homes. Both of them start out with $300 per month utility bills. Okay, Smith's add insulation. Jones are put on solar panels. Smith's upgrade their windows. They become energy conscious. Once you put solar on your home, it's kind of like, oh wow, look what our meter's doing. They install a high efficiency heating and ventilation air conditioning system. They put in some Energy Star appliances. Their net electric savings, probably 50%. Same thing on the other side. The Smiths now have a utility bill of $150, so do the Joneses. Smiths are praised for conservation. The power companies turn around and say, uh-uh, Jonesies, you aren't paying your fair share. Bills are the same. They're the good guys, they're the bad guys. This is the way it gets portrayed here in our legislatures and everything else. That's what the power companies are buying into when they present, I'm sorry, that's what the legislature people are buying into when they hear it from the power companies. These are the facts. So, we can increase the renewable portfolio standard. We have a minimum required purchase of solar right now. We can make it bigger. We can make the net metering and interconnect standards better. We talk about community solar and low-income assistance. Let's get it spread around here. The city of Dallas did have a program back in 2009 with ARRA funding. They had $27 million. You know how much of that got spent on low-income energy assistance? $3 million. Okay. Now, we had a little Q&A session before, unless there are any pressing questions. Let's go ahead and move on. Common concerns. Particularly from cities. I hear this all the time. Solar panels are going to take more energy to manufacture than they produce. That is not true. Solar manufacturing results in more pollution. In the United States, the solar panel companies are very environmentally conscious. In China, that's not necessarily true. It's unfortunate that they are polluting over there, but at least in the United States, we do have responsible companies. Solar energy, they are still thinking it's too expensive. 10 years ago, you could say that. Today, you can't. Costs have come down between 80 and 90% on the solar panels. The first solar panel that I ever bought when I was a kid, I paid $257 a watt. Today, that same panel is 50 cents a watt. Solar equipment is ugly. Now, I hear this from communities, I hear it from council, I hear it from planning and zoning. Take a look. Is this a young lady, or do you see, how many people see a young lady in that image? How many people see an older woman? Okay. The young lady, here is the cheek. Her chin, her nose, eyelash. Here's the older woman. That's now her nose. Here's her mouth. Here's her chin. See it? Once you have it pointed out to you, you see both. But the unfortunate aspect is that when you look at solar, some people say, man, that's gorgeous. Some people say, man, that's ugly. Well, we had a little issue a few years ago with the state fire marshals where they came out and said, You can't have shake roofs. That was that wood shingle roof because they were all flammable. They had a huge fire, more than $10 million up here in the North Dallas area. Actually, isn't Plano. A few years ago, because the shake roofs, one caught next house, next house, next house. I mean, it jumped house to house. $10 million worth of loss because of that. They ended up saying shake roofs, and everybody said, oh my gosh, they're ugly. We don't want composite shingles on our roof, and now guess what? You don't even notice them. Solar panels require more. That is not true. Here's a graph. Studies over and over again have shown it takes less than 2 years energy production to make up for what it took to build that solar panel. And we're talking about the whole thing. Glass, solar cells, frame, the works. You stick that out in the sun, and it will make enough energy in 2 years to repay all the energy that it took to manufacture it. After that, it's free. How long do solar panels last? I hear that. All right, this is a newer technology panel. This is mine. I do have a home up in Wisconsin. It's a summer home. I took this off of my system a few years ago when I made it bigger. This solar panel right here still works. It still produces pretty close to what it did when it was brand new. It's down about 5 or 6%. 38 years old. Now, somebody said, why is it brown? My common response is, if you sat out in the sun for 38 years, you'd look like that too. It still works. Solar panels are heavy. That's not true either. They look heavy. The frames are thick because these have to support snow in some parts of the country or high winds in other parts. The actual solar panel area itself, that's hollow back here. There's a big space. The solar panel area itself is only about 1/4 inch. That's it. The solar panel weighs about 40 pounds. It looks heavy. It's not. That's a concern. People say, oh, I don't want it caving in the roof on the houses. The average weight, including the mounting rack and everything else, is 2.5 pounds per square foot. 2.5 pounds per square foot. Solar panels work better in hot weather. I know that sounds like it's reasonable. My common response, if you have to work in your yard and it's 60 degrees or 110, where do you work better? We all work better when it's cooler. Solar panels are the same way. Their energy output falls off somewhat when they get hot, but our summer days are longer. Consequently, we get a lot more energy from them, even at that reduced level, because of the longer summer days. Solar panels require maintenance? Not really. Worst case, occasionally I hose mine off to get rid of the pollen in the spring. That usually only happens about once a year. After that, nothing. The rain takes care of it. This year the rain took care of it completely. Same thing magically with last year. I haven't washed them in 3 years. I'm sorry? Compressed air? Well, I don't want to climb on my roof to do it. I just put a hose and sprayer on the hose and I wash them from the ground. The water comes back, ends up in the garden because we got gutters. I'm done. Solar energy systems are heavily subsidized. Well, guess what? That is not true either. If we put solar on my house, I'll have electricity if the lights go out. That's not true. Why? Simple fact, you don't have batteries. These go solar panels, inverter, power lines. Lights go off, these turn off. That's a safety feature. Everything will wear out in 10 years. A lot of the companies that lease solar panels sell them on this basis. That is also not true. It's a scare factor. How do I know? I'm a design engineer by profession. If you haven't heard about these little guys, you will. They're called a microinverter. They do exactly the same thing as the bigger ones. It's kind of like having a Cessna or a Boeing 747. These still do the same thing. They're just smaller. You got to have more of them. I helped design this. I'm one of the three engineers on the patent for these things. Now, somebody says, how long will it last? I could have done another PhD on those. For all these studies, testing, everything else, evaluation, in Phoenix, Arizona, the worst heat of the climates anywhere in the nation that I could find, life expectancy on that was 67 years. And that's just where it reaches about 95% of its original efficiency. It's on its way down at that point. It hasn't just quit, doesn't go dead like a battery or go flat like a tire. They just gradually wear out, kind of like a refrigerator. It gradually wears out. It quits cooling so well. These things are going to be the same way. How long? 67 years. This is a little bit of a scare tactic by a lot of the companies that will lease panels because they want you to say, oh my gosh, in 10 years I got to buy everything new, or at least the inverter. I can take them to task and I can prove that they're not being honest, but they've had it told to them so many times, that's the story. And you hear it so frequently in the outside world, you don't know any better. None of those are true. Well, solar panels degrade an average of 0.25% to 0.5% per year. So in 10 years, they're down about 5% from what they were when they were new. I used those for 38 years. The only reason I replaced them wasn't because they weren't doing the job. I just needed more. Why? Well, you get grandkids come up and they leave the lights on, do other things, you know. Now, example here. This came from a report that was prepared for the Nuclear Energy Institute. Not renewable, but take a look here. These are the numbers for the subsidies. Subsidized coal, natural gas, oil, hydro, nuclear, everything here came up to 90%. Look at renewables. And that includes wind. So solar electric was even less than that. Are we heavily subsidized? That wasn't generated by our industry. That was generated by the nuclear guys. I don't call that heavily subsidized in the overall scheme of things. Now, strategic planning for cities, what should we be doing? It's education. Understand the federal, state, and utility policy landscape. Think about your community solar goals. Review your present policies, permitting, planning and zoning, financing. Educate your staff. I spend a lot of time answering questions. Everybody wants to know, but they never spend the time to sit down and learn, or they can't find somebody from whom they can learn it. Understand that too. Well, we're trying to change that. COG is leading the way. Talk to your municipal electric departments. Find out what their policies are, because they are different than commercially or investor-owned utilities. Get them to make it a little bit easier. Talk to them about net metering and other compensation policies. They don't like it because it's a hit on the bottom line. But like it or not, it's coming. And if they don't make some kind of a friendly adaptation here, what people are going to do is they're going to be installing batteries because that's come down, the efficiencies have gone up, costs are improving, everything else. And what's going to end up happening is during times of high usage, they're going to take some of that stored energy and they're going to use it rather than giving it back. And their consumption is still going to go down. That's coming. I'm seeing it right now. It's kind of like watching the sunrise. We're there. Align your zoning and building codes to make them more solar friendly. Take a look at your current policies to the best practices between COGS, information, the Solar Access Toolkit. Look at areas where you can improve. This is where cities can get involved in what they can do. Reach out to others. This is key. We had a community here a few years ago, passed an ordinance, didn't talk to anybody, just passed it. We had another community that said, oh, we think they're ugly, passed an ordinance. Took 6 days for the citizens to get a petition up against it. They don't want the restrictions. So reach out. As a community, reach out to your citizens, reach out to subject matter experts. Get viable input. Now, what's coming? Smart homes. Meaning it'll automatically help adjust for optimal energy use. Time of use. Later in the afternoon, you ever drive the highways and you see the signs that say, okay, the express lanes are $4.50. You go by at 11 o'clock and it's 95 cents. Why is that? Time of use, demand, where the energy needs are the greatest, they're going to bill you the most money. They're also going to give you the most for it when you give it back to them. Home energy storage, that's batteries. Technology is rapidly advancing. I'm seeing that right now. It's happening. increased efficiencies incrementally, ever so slowly. We're seeing gradual improvements just like in car mileage. We're seeing it here also. Continued decreased costs. We're into that zone where it's now cheap enough, and even for the lower income people, it's going to become cost effective. Solar offered a standard in new homes. Well, guess what? That's already happening. These are home builders around the nation right now. This is a survey taken by the National Association of Home Builders of their members, and they found KB Home right now is developing 22 communities that include solar as standard as built. But we've got other developers offering them either as a standard feature or as a standard option. A lot of these you'll recognize because they're builders here. They haven't done it here because it hasn't been a solar-friendly landscape. We can change that. A lot of these homes you recognize. This came from the National Association of Home Builders, and this was in 2014. This is a slide that you saw in the beginning. This is where we're going now. In our local area, we have seen a 744% growth since 2008, in the last 8 years. Huge uptick, and that curve has not slowed down. In fact, it's getting faster, more vertical. Okay, permitting and ordinance considerations. We realize that when communities are faced with it, they tend to err on the side of caution. They make the ordinances more restrictive than need be and find that it's easier to back it down. It's also expensive, time-consuming, and everything else to have to go back and revisit it. So do it right the first time. You get proper input, you don't have to do it twice. Again, COG has the best practices for permitting and other templates on their website. These were done with input from a variety of both local, regional, and national sources. They're well developed. You don't have to go back and reinvent the wheel. Public opinion. This is something that was taken out of Flower Mound in 2010. There were 2,332 homeowners asked. They actually went out and polled their own members. Almost 30% responded, and a majority, in fact, the number turned out to be 74%, said, we want solar. Survey after survey proves this. City of Flower Mound had an HOA president who was very disgruntled about it come in and say, we want this. And they convinced their senior planner to go in and request this from planning and zoning. When all was said and done, as approved by the city council, they removed all of the aesthetic and other limitations. They left the safety. Flower Mound, good for you. This is what the city wanted. Why? Because they went out and they actually sought input from experts. They sought input from their community. Turns out they were fortunate. At least one member of their planning and zoning commission also had solar on his home. So, City of Southlake, they did the same thing. They had a survey mailed to 450 residents where somebody around them was going to be installing solar. Of the 450, 52 were returned. And again, magically, it was about 75% responded in favor. That is on the Southlake website. HOA law, we talked about it. Revisit it again here. The 10% rule generally is the biggest thing. There's also some other things. They say, well, you must install solar panels that are either black, silver, or bronze color in the metal framing. Guess what? That's the only three colors they make. The biggest thing is you can't stick it out over the edge of the roof. That's a safety consideration. Everything else, you follow the rules, you're going to get solar on your home if you live in an HOA. They cannot prohibit it. Very, very overwhelming. If we take a look at it, the House passed it 143-3, and the Senate passed it unanimously. This is not a partisan issue. Now, from a developer, this is a company that has over 4,000 properties under development right now. This is a company called Wilborn. Take a look. These are high-end homes, from $300,000 to more than $5 million in value. This is a letter, and I realize it's hard to read, so what I've done here, I enlarged just a few little sections. As a property developer with headquarters in Australia and so forth, you can read it. We elect not to prohibit solar panels in our communities. There is a misperception that it lowers property values, where in fact just the opposite is true. It raises them. Solar raises property values. We, meaning as a public here in the United States, take the wrong approach by regulating technology based on aesthetics. Don't worry about it. It'll become like the shingles. As regulators of buildings, cities should not impede the technological advances. Your job is to make sure they're safe. This is a survey taken by the National Association of Home Builders. This is in 2014. Look what happens. By 2018, 84% of the home builders, member of National Association of Home Builders, say they're going to be offering solar as a standard option on their homes, either included or, hey, if the buyer wants it, they'll put it in. Hail we talked about, they'll handle a 1-inch hailstone at 55 miles an hour. We talked about this one, 2.5 pounds per square foot. Shock hazard, nope. You can't get shocked by a solar electric system. If the utility power goes off, this system ceases to operate within thousandths of a second. They will not power the neighborhood. They will not power your house. Utility power goes off, your house goes dark just like everybody else's. Solar panels, I know some cities want to mount them flat against the roof. Bad idea. Number one, solar panels need air underneath them to help cool them. You get them too hot, that's trapping the heat. It's like parking your car in the sun with the windows shut. Bad for the, in this case, it's bad for the interior, bad for the plastic. In this case, the heat is bad for the solar panels. It shortens their life and causes them to operate much less efficiently. Solar panels can, no, we want them facing the sun. I know of at least one installation here. If you happen to go by on Highway 183, at the 121 split, if you're kind of in that area, in the Bedford area, there's a house that got them mounted on the north side, and for reasons I still don't understand. They're facing away from the sun. Don't know. They need to face south. They can face east and west and still generate some, and people will put them on the south and east and west just to get the most energy production out of their roof. You're talking about making them follow the sun? No, you don't put them on the roof because they need a lot more space and then they got to... No, you will not find a mechanism to make them follow the sun on a rooftop. It's just not practical. Even on a flat roof. It's just not practical. It's a moving part. They have to be tilted and they got to be high enough, and at that point they're a sail in the wind. The only time you'll ever see it is when they're firmly anchored. Now, professional engineer has to analyze and stamp every roof plan. City of Dallas, this is yours. I know there are other communities. I'm picking on you guys because I've tried to. I'm a PE. I guess we're going to have to get a lot of us to say something here. Okay. Here was a study that was just actually released about 6 weeks ago. And it was literally by Sandia National Laboratories. And what they discovered after testing, they literally built roofs and broke them. Built roofs and broke them. What were these roofs doing? They found that the code was actually 330%, the code roof was 330% stronger than what code was estimating. So you can go back if you happen to have a requirement in an ordinance that says we got to have a structural PE, stamp it, and if it's got 2x6 rafters and they're 24 inches apart or less, we're golden. Now, glare. I've seen cities say, oh, what about glare? Anybody recognize this building? How about now? Can you see it? Little place called DFW International. See the yellow circle? That's the airport development engineer building. Look at the main runways. Here's one. Here's the other. If glare were an issue, would that be there? Now, is that never to say never? No, I'm sure there are the rarest of circumstances where something could go wrong. That's like saying, gee, always wear your seatbelt, it's guaranteed to 100% protect you, and then you hear about somebody strangled by a seatbelt. 1 in 10 million, it happens. Here was a study done in Oregon. They put these alongside a highway. The community was over here. They literally brought in a consulting firm who did the math, said you would have to be at 400 feet elevation up, 40 stories up before you'd ever even see the glare. from those solar panels. Sunlight is reflected up, not down. Now, historic districts. You want to keep it historically, visually true to its origins. The approach normally is just to keep them mounted out of sight. Not always workable. So, we have some options here. If you have planning, if you've got historic districts in your community, here is a report on where you can go for help on working solar panels into a historic district. Now, we talked about this. This is the same program that they're working through right now. Permitting is less expensive for your community. That's a given. I don't have to teach you that. You already know it. Right now, and what I did, where did this number come from? I sat down and I researched all 237 communities in the municipal metroplex area. I looked up every single city, their permitting, their ordinances. More than 90%, actually the number is 94%, are running on permitting. 6% have ordinances and so forth. Things to do: get a permitting process, establish clear rules, publish those things on the website so that people know it makes less work for you and for them, and then utilize the expedited permitting process when possible. That's what these folks have been doing for the last 2 years, so you don't have to reinvent the wheel as cities. Solar infrastructure, yeah, we're still in the beginning. We've been around for, you know, 40, 50 years, but we're still getting started. A lot of changes. Well, 7 to 12 year return on investment is still considered too long. That's not true. Show me another investment. Will your house give you a complete double return on your investment in 7 to 12? Guarantee not. But that doesn't bother people. Forward-thinking cities are actually requiring solar. San Francisco is the first large city, but other cities around our country, Tucson, Lancaster, California, others, because they're now saying new construction has to have solar already. I'm not saying solar ready or solar available, has to have solar on it. Elected officials may not know what questions to ask, and they're too embarrassed to admit it, or they're too busy, they got other priorities. I understand you're dealing with thousands of things at one time. City staff, they're up to here. I gave a presentation for one of our communities. It was incorporated into the packet at the council meeting. And when I got done, I went to one of the council members and I said, well, based on your comment, you apparently didn't understand the information that you just voted on. And he said, what information? I said, it's in the packet. He said, I didn't read the packet. The information was there and you just voted on something and you didn't read it. He said, no, I went on my gut. Okay, we know we got an uphill battle. Germany, other citizens around the world are very well educated. Here's an example. Our customer acquisition costs are what it costs to actually, say, go out and find and get, and somebody says, okay, fine, I'll do it. But look at the permitting and interconnection costs and labor. Compare that to Germany. Here in America, this is the average cost. This comes from the Rocky Mountain Institute, the area research and so forth, an information firm, organization. 5 to 1. They're 80% cheaper over in Germany than they are here. That's a huge difference now. Implement the expedited permitting. Establish a low-cost flat rate fee for expedited permitting. I know one community that charges $50, another community wanted to charge $585. Same process. Go across the street, it's 10 to 1. Both required special use permits. One was $50, one was $585. Why? Same process. Just because one city said they could. Try to get online permitting. Save your own employee time. State what requirements. You say, gee, you've already said that. Yeah, you got to say it 3 or 4 times. Doesn't sink in. Provide a standardized template. Reduce the processing time. Saves you as a city money. Minimize the number of inspections. Don't need 5 or 6. Letter from a realtor, property values. This came from a lady named Beth Johnson, Keller Williams. Last sentence in the first paragraph, there is no evidence to suggest that solar lowers values regarding either subject property or neighboring homes. This is a lady that has got more than 24 years experience in it. There has never been a suggestion in any of these courses that the presence of solar will subtract value from the subject or nearby properties. In all of her classes, never been an issue. Here was a home. It's hard to find houses that are inside of solar homes when the house sells. This is one over in North Richland Hills. That's kind of my neighborhood a little bit. I'm in North Fort Worth. That was listed, actually it was listed May 28, 2014 and sold July 6. So that's even a little bit misleading. It was only on the market for 6 weeks. That house sold, they got their asking price, and right out their back door they have that view of that home with all those solar panels. It did not impede the sale. Expedited permitting, we've already talked about it. Tamara did a great job. We've covered this. I'm just going to kind of zip through it just a little bit. Pre-qualify certain system configurations. Simplify and standardize the application. Pre-qualify some of your installers. You know you've got some good ones. There are some snakes. That's the problem. You got the snakes out there. You know they're going to be trouble. Okay. At least pre-qualify some of them. Make the others go through all the hoops. Reduce the number of inspections. Again, duplication. Eliminate the need for structural PE. Compare the expedited permitting template to your present process. Here it is in detail. Number one, let's go ahead and, that's item number one, site information. Item number two, what kind is it, residential or commercial? Check box, you're done. Item number three, what's the equipment being used? What's the total weight? That's from the installer, you can get a number. Total number of attachment points, these are just basics. Okay, now we go to page two, contractor. What's their name, company, contact? Maximum capacity, as long as it won't exceed 120%. If you got a 200 amp breaker panel, you can install up to 40 amps of solar without any problem at all. Code compliance, it's gonna be compliant to code, we know it is. The zoning variance isn't required, it's not in historic districts. Equipment standards all meet the required safety standards. Check, 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 we're done. Meets those and these, you qualified for expedited permitting. That's it. Makes it super simple. Technology's present and future. A lot of this is kind of sort of, now I realize we visited this a moment ago, smart homes, they make more intelligent use of the energy. Time of use, we talked about, here it is explained. Tiered billing, out in California, they got five levels. The more you use, the more expensive it gets. Here we're paying an average of around 10 cents a kilowatt hour. You use 1,000 kilowatt hours a month, that's a $100 utility bill, plus your taxes. Out in California, they get to a certain level, it's not 10 cents, it's 51 cents. That makes solar very viable. Batteries, people are going to want to store some of it and use it, especially during the expensive times of the day. We see increased energy efficiency. A new material that has been recently discovered has evidence of showing almost a double of the solar energy conversion. So this panel right here, which would be 180 watts today, would be 360 watts using that new process. That's monumental, and at the same price. At that point, I'm covering my roof. Gradual decrease in the costs. We're seeing it gradually trickle down. There's no huge plunges. We're just gradually seeing a decrease. Solar offered a standard. Yep, we rehashed this a moment ago. No need to go over it again. Now, I'm going to bring up something here on the screen. Any idea who might have said that? Anybody else have a guess? Not sure. I'd say that's pretty insightful. Now, I'm going to throw the floor open. We've got a little bit of time now. I want to take a few minutes and show everybody how solar works. I don't mean this as a slap at bankers. They tend to be the least technical of the people that I talk to. I can show them this little display, and in less than 60 seconds, they get it. That's all that matters. You can be zero technical. I promise you, you will understand it when we get finished right here. Now, everybody can see this from the seats. I'm going to turn it on. This is kind of like closing the circuit breaker on my house. Ready? Now, since we don't have a solar panel, I got an artificial solar panel right here. It plugs into the wall, but it provides the same electricity as a solar panel would. Back here, I also have my appliances, my air conditioner, my refrigerator. I also have my inverter. This is going to create electricity. Now, I want you to take a look. This is the meter that's showing how much electricity it's producing. That is my house electricity meter over there. The meter in the middle is just to confuse you. Don't worry about it. Can you see that meter, everybody? I'm sorry? Well, these are exaggerated. These are modified meters on purpose so that you can see it. But you can already see that that meter is running backwards. I'm making solar electricity here. That's going backwards. Let me turn on the lights here. Now, you can already watch that one slow down. Let's say my air conditioner comes on now. Click. Now I'm using more than I am making with my sun and solar equipment. Now I'm buying from the power company. See that? It changed direction. Right now I'm consuming, but let's just pretend my solar weren't there. I'm still conserving. I just turned off my inverter. Look what happened to my house meter. I didn't change anything except I turned off the inverter. Let me turn the inverter back on. Sun comes back out. It's the next morning. Now, you can watch this come on very, very slowly. Sun's coming up. Takes a little while. My air conditioner shuts off. I'm still using electricity. As this increases, because the sun's coming up in the east, I'm getting more and more sunlight on my solar panels. Watch that meter over there. What's it doing? Watch it. Watch it. There you go. What just happened? Keep going. See, we kind of hit a balance. Now it's going the other way. Now I'm powering everything in my home with the sun. That's feeding everything that I'm using. And I'm still giving some back. We've got solar on our home. That's how it works. People tend to become more energy conscious when they have solar on their home. How many people here have ever ridden in a hybrid automobile? A lot of you. You ever notice there's a little screen in there that shows you what your miles per gallon are? And it becomes an almost game to see how better, you know, oh, hey, I'm at 47, I want to get up to 48. That doesn't change the amount of fuel, that doesn't change the ignition, that doesn't change the timing, that doesn't change anything except the driver. That one little instrument has done more to improve gas mileage than some of the other changes in the cars. You put solar on a home, people become more conscious about it. You know, one of my favorite stories is that I became aware of how well and how little people knew all about it at the same time. 12, 14 years ago when we moved into the neighborhood, I used to be out in another part of the country and came here, wife, daughter, everybody was, okay, put solar hot water on the system on our house first. Got it all finished. Got it finished on a Thursday afternoon. And I said, oh good, tomorrow night, Friday, I'm going home, I'm going to take a solar hot shower. Pulled into the garage, looked at the little box on the wall, had a thermostat in it, and it said 88 degrees, and I went, hold it. That's supposed to be like 150. What did I do wrong? So I went in the house, as I opened the door, all of a sudden I get this little cloud of steam, and I hear all these girl voices. My daughter had some of her friends over. And I went, oh, okay, and all of a sudden, here comes one of the little young ladies. You know, how do they do that, a towel with a turban kind of? And I said, hello, Tiffany. Well, hello, Mr. Pinsky. I said, did everything? I said, you just took a shower? Yeah. I said, how was it? Oh, it felt so good. So I went down, Michelle, come here a minute, my daughter. I said, you know, you guys, how many friends you got? Well, we just got four of us. So three and her. I said, okay, everybody take a shower? Uh-huh. I said, you know, this is like 6 o'clock and now we're kind of out of hot water. I didn't tell her we had electric backup. I hadn't turned it on yet. I never did tell them, by the way. And I said, you realize we're out of solar hot water now? She said, but Dad, you said it was like free. I went, oh boy. Okay. I said, yeah, it's not going to cost us anything to heat our water, but it's not infinite. So you have to be aware of that as you go through this. There are things that you have to do in the usage habits, but you as communities can make it solar friendly. Cedar Hill did that a year and a half ago. They put together a very solar friendly ordinance. Don Gore, senior planner, Rod Tyler, planning and zoning director, credit to them. They went out and they really did their due diligence. And they came out with a solar friendly ordinance in the city of Cedar Hill, right next door, and their council on passing it came back out and said, we want to add an addendum to this. We want to encourage our citizens to put on solar equipment. It's the right thing to do. Remove the impediments as communities. Get rid of some of the soft costs, lower your costs in the process. Ask for help. We're not all guys. We don't all know the right directions. Don't tough it through. Seek outside help. COG's your first starting point. Those people have got a wealth of resources available. Any questions?